Thank you for listening to the BJJ Brick Podcast. We'll be bringing you Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu and good times. We hope to flatten your Jiu-Jitsu learning curve, help you get the most out of your grappling ability, and meet your goals both on and off the mat.
Welcome back, my friends, to episode 96 of the BJJ Brick Podcast. This is Byron. I'm here with my buddy Gary, and we also have Sam Spiegelman answering your questions about strength and conditioning this week. Gary, how's it going, man?
It is going great. Can't complain. We got a great episode this week. Sam Spiegelman, I think, is probably one of all of our favorites guests. Very, very knowledgeable. Strength and conditioning, very knowledgeable in jiu-jitsu. We got a heck of a show today.
Absolutely. We're both excited about this one.
And it's really our first question and answer show. And we're on episode 96. That means we're 8 from 100. And it's our first one that has question and answer, I think.
Yeah, it's our first question and answer show. And I think we should have done this a while ago, but I don't know why we haven't done it. So,
Well, you want to know the bad thing is, it actually wasn't our idea. It was Sam's idea. He's the smart one. We can't figure this stuff out. So that's why we need the help of our listeners here.
Yep, our listeners and the interviewees, you know, that's always good. And the listeners sent in questions and it was good. It's what you want to know. I mean, it's not what I'm curious about or Gary's curious about. It's what the general listeners, they want to know. And it covers a wide variety of topics about strength and conditioning, everything from cutting weight to eating a healthy breakfast.
We're supposed to eat breakfast?
Typically, I think it's recommended by most people that recommend things like that.
So stay tuned for that.
Even some recipe tips, you know, it's like he gives you some good advice, you know, and then next week it's just boom, keep going, you know, it's just more questions. So
speaking of good advice, we have an email list. You'll see you on our page there where you can sign up, and basically what that'll do is that'll get you reminder every Tuesday that the show's out, so you'll never miss a show. But it also gives you a Dropbox with some knowledge. We're dropping knowledge in the Dropbox. But you know, one you can check out here, one of our audio books there that Byron's put together in the Dropbox is how to compete in a Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu tournament, even if you're on a busy schedule, and that happens to everybody. It's 30 minutes of a lot of great ideas, and basically just for signing up to our email list, that'll get you access to that. So definitely check it out. Mm-hmm. And as always, our disclaimer, we do not sell your name. The email list is basically just to get our podcast out to you on Tuesdays.
Yep, and I don't think I've ever sent out like a second email in 1 week. It's like an automatic thing. Post the podcast, and the day after that, it gets emailed out. And in theory, I could send, hey, you know, Gary and I are doing this, and let you guys know. And I don't think anybody would care, but that's extra work. And Gary, we're working hard enough as is. But
yeah, and nobody cares what we're doing.
Well, I care what you're doing. Sometimes.
Oh, thank you, Byron. You're a good man.
Everybody wants to know what Gary's up to.
Yeah, we'll get to that a little bit later.
So that's a good way to keep up with us. If you want to support us, we do have an audiobook for sale. It's basically a long podcast. It's about a 2.5 hour long podcast, and I'm going to take you through your first year of BJJ. And there's a lot that I'll cover in there, everything from finding the right gym for you. So before you even start, all the way up to tournaments and what you should, maybe you should or should not do a tournament, and what you should be doing, you know, to get ready. And also I talk about your training schedule. I realize people are busy, and what you should be doing, to get the most you can out of your training in the time you have. So it's a little book I made a little while ago. It's $11.99. It's just it's a way to support the podcast and help us, keep on the air.
So definitely check it out.
Gary, let's do another throwback quote. It's kind of fun. We've got such a library of quotes that we're able to pull up old quotes whenever we need necessary and share them with the audience that may have not heard a quote. This one's from episode 58, Amanda Lowen. So here's a quote from our friend Amanda Lowen.
I remember several times just like stomping into my coach's office, just being like, blah, 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 these things aren't working, and I don't understand. Why am I not getting better? What am I supposed to be doing with my life? And he's just like, he'll tell me every time, he's like, frustration is a useless emotion. I'm just like, damn it, okay, fine. So, and then, you know, one of our other coaches, Preet from Estonia as well, he's just like, go tear some tissues and then come back on the mat. So I think those things really are important. It's just like, frustration isn't going to help your jiu-jitsu at all. And if you do get frustrated, go tear some tissues, figure it out, and then come back on the mat. So I think those things are, you know, those things are good advice and take to heart.
That was Amanda Lowen with Frustration is a Useless Emotion. And sometimes it's just an automatic emotion. I mean, we're all people. You get frustrated. That's part of life. But yeah, if you could realize it's useless, that might help you get over it a little quicker.
Yeah, it's a sport. We're trying to have fun. We're trying to learn. We're going to have ups and downs. We're going to have bad days. And bad days on the mat, we're going to get frustrated. And like you said, it's a useless emotion. I don't know. I look at it this way. To me, a bad day on the mat where I'm frustrated is a heck of a lot better than a good day at work. So, I've always said that to myself. I'd rather be on the mats having a bad day than be at work.
That's true, Gary. You got to appreciate that you're actually be able to get on the mat today and that you're healthy enough to do that. And
yeah.
And that, you know, the little things that you may overlook when you're having, you know, when you get submitted 9 times in a row by the new guy. That's frustrating.
That happens to me a lot. You know, the guy who's never trained before, never done any athletic endeavor in his life, and then just comes in here, and it happens to me a lot. So I know where that's coming from.
Is it frustrating, Gary?
It's frustrating. But I'd rather be getting tapped out than being at work. So there.
So there we go. Hey, it's a good day. You're out. You're training.
Yeah.
You're frustrated. Yep. You compete. It doesn't go well. Hey, you got to compete. You know, you got to meet some new people. You got to see your team get up there and compete. Try to take it in stride and try to just – it's not going to help you to get better to be frustrated. You know, I think, you know, if you could go and ask everybody who's done jiu-jitsu for a year or two and then quit, why they quit, if you could probably look down at the root of it, you know, maybe a lot of them were just schedule changes, the lifestyle changes, they couldn't keep up with it and things like that. But a lot of it probably was frustration. You know, I was getting any better. You know, I took a month off and I didn't want to come back, and I came back and I sucked. You know, like, that's a useless emotion. You know, try to limit it, the frustration in your life.
You know, I'm kind of lucky that the way I am, when I get frustrated with something, and I definitely got frustrated for the first 4 or 5 years of doing jiu-jitsu, but I don't know, I've got that in me where I don't quit, and frustration kind of leads me to try a little bit harder sometimes. I mean, I'm a little different than some people, but I've got that mantra in me that I'll never quit. I always say, you know, I'm not going to quit. No ifs, ands, or buts. And that frustration leads me sometimes to just say, hey, I need to get back out there. I need to figure out what I'm doing wrong. So sometimes it has helped me a little bit because I've run into a lot of frustration, but just my mind works a little different than some people. And it kind of just forces me to keep going, to try to get better. I want to get good at it.
So you change the frustration to motivation, it sounds like.
Yeah, it really turns into motivation. I guess, because it is something, I guess when I started it, something I wanted to try to get decent at. You know, I wanted to get better at. And I do kind of use that as motivation to keep training, because I know that it's going to get better. I know that one of these days I'm going to be that guy leading the pack. And now, after 13 years of rolling, I don't think I'm ever going to be leading the pack. But I thought I was going to get there someday. But no, I enjoy the sport very, very much.
There we go. Very good stuff, Gary. And thanks to our friend Amanda Lowen for the quote. If you want to hear her interview, she was on episode 58, where you could just type in Amanda Lowen on the search bar on the website there, bjjbrick.com.
And yep, episode right 58, half of 100. So check that episode out.
Our mathematician at works. Gary, what I usually do when I want to find somebody that we've interviewed, I just type their name in on Google and then type in BJJ Brick, and usually it pops right up.
You'll find it.
I don't go to the website first and then try to find them. I just type it all on Google. Gary, the music is telling us, like always, we've got to keep the show moving because people want to hear the article. Then they want to get on to the question and answer segment with Sam Spiegelman. We've got a great article, sandhillsbjj.wordpress.com. Sandhill's Ponderings About Jiu-Jitsu. The article is titled, What Sharpens Iron? And the classic expression is iron sharpens iron. But in Jiu-Jitsu, it's important to train with everybody. And this article talks about three different types of training partners. One training partner is way better than you. You know, you're the white belt, blue belt, rolling with the black belt, brown belt, and unless they're like allowing you to do things, it's very one-sided, and you're fighting a very defensive battle. And the other type of training partner would be the one that's about equal with you, and it's a battle. It's more fun to watch. You know, two people who are equal, then one way better. It's a lot more energy. You're going to have to do your technique correctly, or as correctly as you possibly can, in order to get it to work. And you also need to be ready to be on the defense. You know, when you're with the upper belt, you're going to be generally on the defense. And then you have a third type of training partner, one that's not as good as you. And this is a good person to test out some technique and to maybe introduce a little bit of a playful style and to go outside of your comfort zone. So those are the three different types of training partners that are talked about primarily in this article. It's interesting. You always hear you want to train with the best guys, your best people you could get with to train. But really, you do need some other things in that mix. You do need other types of partners to help you get better.
Yeah, and I always took this from you. You would always talk about trying new moves, trying new positions. And you used to always say, I'm going to start with the new guy. And, you know, I get the newer person and I start working it with that person for a couple weeks and, you know, getting the setups, getting everything right. And you're always like, then I do it against the guy. He's like, then I know it's really starting to work when I can do it against the guy who's just as good as me. You know, then all of a sudden that sweep works. And you think about it. If you had to start working a new move on a guy who's just as good as you or better than you, you're probably never going to get that move down. You have to have that new guy to work on it, to get into that position, to start troubleshooting, then work your way up. And you just work your way up the ladder. And then once you hit somebody who's, you know, you've really got a good command of it, when you hit somebody who's better, hit the move on somebody who's better than you.
Yeah, that's a good way to bring in new, you know, you bring in a new technique. You want to drill a little bit, pry it with a you know, willing opponent, but really need to get it on the mat against an unwilling opponent. Start with the people who are a little bit, you know, less skilled than you, and work your way up the chain.
Yeah. Or adopt a dog. Yeah. Yep. And practice there.
But he also talks about the importance of the upper belts training with the lower belts. And it's almost like a responsibility that, upper belts trained with you when you were new. You know, it's we need to keep sharing the knowledge and pass it down. It also, it's up to the upper belt to gain something from this training session. If you're a black belt rolling with a white belt and you don't get anything out of that, and you do it for, you know, let's just say you move to the middle of nowhere, you're starting your school, and you can't seem to get anything beneficial from any of the people that you trained with for like 2 years, that's your fault.
That's, yeah, definitely your fault.
You've got to train in a way that you're able to learn even with the students who aren't as good. And he mentioned, you know, get in a bad spot and don't worry. Just be relaxed and work your way through that. And if you start with a bad spot with somebody who's better than you or your same skill level, it's hard to relax in that spot. But you can if the person isn't really able to capitalize on a lot of the things you're doing. And you could carry that, you know, that relaxation and lower heart rate and respiratory rate over to a little bit higher of a level each time.
Yeah, and that's the key, like you said, the lower heart rate, the lower respiratory level. And
so that kind of wraps up our article. It's got a lot more stuff on there, but that's basically what was discussed in there. What sharpens iron? It's on sandhillsbjj.wordpress.com. Check it out. We'll put a link to that in the show notes, of course. And check it out.
So check it out. Byron, I think it's about that time. Time for the question and answer in strength and conditioning with Sam Spiegelman.
Great idea, Gary. Here we go.
Grapplers, come out and roll. Grapplers, come out and roll. Grapplers, come out and roll.
All right now, for all you grapplers out there on the big mat, I've been asked to send out a request The BJJ Brick Podcast is going to need some help on this one. They are in it deep. Real deep. They want you to write them a funny review on iTunes. If you think you can. If you feel like they've been doing good. Real good. They would love it if you gave them 5 stars. Make some jokes, please. You can even do it at their expense. They will read it on the podcast. And of course, for your efforts, they will be happy to send you out a gi patch. A BJJ Brick gi patch.
Okay, my friends, I have Sam Spiegelman here on the BJJ Brick podcast again. He was last year on episode 82. We talked about strength and conditioning. He's back by popular demand. We've got a big list of questions that I'm going to throw his way, and we're gonna get answers for the listeners, and it's going to be good times, and it's going to be educational for anybody who has questions of strength and conditioning. I think we'll hit a lot of different topics and help a lot of people out. So, Sam, welcome back to the BJJ Brick podcast.
Thanks for having me back, guys. It's awesome. Great experience.
Yep, you've got you're one of the fan favorite episodes. Everybody seemed to really get a kick out of it, and we've piled a collection of questions for you. Sam, if somebody missed your last episode, why don't you just give yourself a little introduction here before we get started with the questions?
Okay, my name is Sam Spiegelman. I train out of New Breed Training Center in Chicago. I'm an instructor there, and I also run Applied Training Condition Chicago, and we do strength and conditioning for everybody, pretty much. Focus primarily on jiu-jitsu guys, probably our biggest market, so to speak, right now. But we have everybody from, you know, the average Joe that wants to work out, football players, basketball players. We have a pretty good run of other athletes that come to our gym that want to train. We do pretty much everything in-house, so I try to look at each athlete as an individual, develop programs from there, and I also have the ability to teach jiu-jitsu. So based on that, I get a lot of questions, I get a lot of feedback, I get a lot of, you know, I get to see a lot of people and hear their stories and see what they need and what they're craving and what they're looking for, and they're looking for answers, you know, and that's hopefully what I can help with.
Perfect. I like your approach. Everyone's an individual. So as we go through these questions here, remember that you're likely in a unique situation. You know, some people are more, I guess, towards the average than others, but you know, not every question is going to be perfectly suited for you. And Sam will try to hit the range and kind of help guide where people might be when he answers a question. I hope. So let's get going here. The first question we have is a basic training question from new people. How often should you train when you are new to jiu-jitsu?
It's a great question. For new people, one thing you'll experience really fast is how strenuous jiu-jitsu is. I know from the outside, you know, it looks so awesome. Everybody's kind of moving around, pulling around, you know, putting your body in all kinds of funny positions. But it's also very strenuous. The reason it looks easy for a lot of the guys you see training or girls is that they're very efficient. So it might appear that they're using a lot of energy or moving around, but to them they're not. You know, like you can see high level black belts roll 20-minute rounds and they look pretty okay after. So for someone new, they're very inefficient. So they're using a lot of strength, they're using every muscle in their body to do the simplest movement, they're not breathing. So it's a lot more taxing than people realize. So at first, you might only need twice a week. I mean, it might be the only way you can recover efficiently is to train twice a week. In a perfect world, if your recovery is great, I would say 3 days a week is perfect. You don't need to go, you know, 6-7 days a week or, you know, twice a day for months and then disappear, you know. People come in, they train really hard for a few weeks, and they're like, oh, I'm so beat up, I can't train anymore. So I would say stick to a number that you can be consistent for a long period of time. So what I've seen is 2 to 3 days a week seems to be a good number to shoot for. And then obviously as you get more efficient, you could bump that up.
And just a little follow-up question, is it good to kind of space those days out, or is it okay to put them all in a row?
Yeah, ideally you would space them out. You know, when you first start training, you'll get the delayed muscle soreness, or DOMS, is what it's called. So you might not get sore the day after. It might be like a day or, you know, 2 days after. So in reality, like, if you have the option to, then yes, you'd space them out. But most people that do jiu-jitsu, it's a hobby to them, and they work, or, you know, they have families, whatever it is. They might not have that luxury. Maybe the only 2 days they can get in is back-to-back. So if that's the case, then you just do whatever you can. But in a perfect world where we're, you know, time and all that stuff isn't an issue, I would space them out at least 2 to 3 days apart.
Okay, very good. Next question here. What level of class is best to start with?
Great question. Recently, a lot of schools offer like a fundamental program or an intro program that have, you know, whether mostly technique, maybe some drilling, or maybe some positional drilling or sparring. But up until before this, most schools just had one level of class. It was, you just showed up to class, and what it is, you know, it would be the same class as brown belts, purple belts, black belts, new guy, all trained together. So if your school does have the option to start with like a beginner class or with a intro type program, you know, I would say at least start there. How long you stay there is going to be individual. So some people feel more comfortable starting with that beginner program, that intro program, for an extended period of time until they build up a knowledge base and go to the more advanced class, or maybe there's like an intermediate class or whatever. Other people might do it for a week or two. They just want to move to something a little bit more intense or higher pace. So I think what the beginner classes do really well is they meet the need for the people that are very intimidated to come into the jiu-jitsu gym, have no experience, and just don't know what to expect. But you'll get guys that are, let's say, they played a sport in high school, and they'll get bored in a class like that. They want that, like, they just want to get thrown in the fire. So if that's how your personality is and your school allows it, then you might be better off just starting in a, you know, mixed-level class or an all-level class, whatever they offer. But if you are that type of person that is a little timid, or you're not sure what to expect from jiu-jitsu, then I think the beginner or the intro, some people call them fundamental classes, are your best bet. And you will, obviously everybody needs fundamentals, but it'll also get you comfortable with the sport of martial arts jiu-jitsu before you jump into something more advanced.
Yeah, it seems like sometimes when you get a newer student in to the regular class, that's the week we happen to be working on like a tricky guard sweep or something that that they're not really going to pick up and go from,
yeah.
From there. So
yeah, that is challenging too. I do think at first, like the first 6 months, 7 months period of a new student that's like just started with all-level or intermediate class, there might be some fundamentals that they miss just because they're not taught right away, or it just happens that they're at a point in the curriculum where they're doing something that's definitely not a beginner technique. So I think there will be a little bit of loophole if, again, looking back at like a perfect scenario, you do a little bit of both. So if you have the option of training 2 days a week, maybe one day you do a fundamental beginner, one day you do intermediate, or, you know, all-level class, depending on what your school calls it. Then you get a little bit of both worlds. Same thing if you train 3 days a week, you know, you can do two of the fundamentals, one of the all-level. So if you find yourself in that position where you feel like you're missing some pieces, or you're missing some of the basics, then I would recommend kind of comboing together.
That sounds like a good plan. Going on to the next question here. Should I do extra cardio to get in better shape for BJJ?
That's another great question, one that I probably hear the most often. There really is no way to replace the conditioning and the feeling you'll get of being on the mat. You know, running, swimming, biking, you know, running hills, all that stuff. Like it's great. Activity, it's a great, I guess, cardio, if you want to think of that, like a heart rate boost and that, but it doesn't necessarily translate to jiu-jitsu. You could be in phenomenal shape, as a marathon runner, biker, whatever, football player, and you do jiu-jitsu and you're struggling. So you don't need to do any extra conditioning, extra cardio, anything like that to get in shape. If someone's brand new, they always say, like, oh, should I get in shape before I do it? I say, no, you just have to start with jiu-jitsu. Now, for the person that's been training a while, there are some off-the-mat things you could do that will get you close to the same heart rate level and same, like, stimulus you'll get in jiu-jitsu. But they involve doing jiu-jitsu movements with speed or for time or with resistance. So you take something like standing up in the guard or something. Like, you start on your knees and stand up. Maybe you add a resistance band, or you hang like a kettlebell or something, or dumbbell around your jiu-jitsu belt. So when you stand up, you have a little bit of extra resistance, and you just do it for time or for speed. So that type of extra conditioning can help. But again, you're mirroring jiu-jitsu movements, so you don't need to do any extra conditioning for the most part. But for the people that do want that, or they're a high level competitor, you're gonna get more bang for your buck by mirroring jiu-jitsu as much as you can.
That's good advice. It seems like a lot of times, we were talking about earlier how much you could train a week or should train. It's just like a scheduling troubles. You know, jiu-jitsu class is offered at 6:30. Well, I only have 2 days I could do that, but I could always every morning get up and do some cardio training. So I think that's also a time that people are like, is that worth it? Does it help? Is it making a big difference?
Yeah, that's a good point. You know, that morning block of time for the majority of jiu-jitsu people, or the majority of everybody, could be spent doing some sort of mobility routine, just some sort of, I know you guys have had CBACs a lot a couple times, like something like his joint mobility movements, or just getting up and moving your joints in the morning, I think would be more beneficial than if you went out and did a run, you know, and people say, like, it helps you burn extra calories, lose weight, something like that. Like, yeah, I guess it could. You know, it does. But it's still not, you know, the goal is to get better, more conditioned for jiu-jitsu. You know, we're not talking about, like, an obese person trying to lose weight. So I would say if you do have the opportunity in the morning, you have some time, you could do something as simple as, you know, some joint mobility work, you know, old-fashioned walking. You know, walk 10 minutes one way, walk 10 minutes back. Come home, it's 20 minutes, do like another 10 minutes of mobility work. You got your body moving for, you know, 20, 30 minutes, and it'll pay off over the long haul. You won't feel, joint mobility is not something you'll do one day and you'll feel great. Once you do it over time, the days you don't do it, you'll start to feel different. You'll feel a little tighter, or not as awake, so to speak. So I would say, use that morning time for something like that. I mean, it can help you with, you know, injury prevention or just overall longevity and health.
Sounds good. Speaking, since we're on the topic of morning time, we'll jump down the list here a little bit to the next question. Do you have any advice to have a quick and easy and healthy breakfast?
Yeah. Breakfast gets a lot of airtime lately, because there's a group that are the intermittent fasting crowd where they say skip breakfast, and you get the group that you have to have breakfast, and you get the high carb group. I do think that it is individual. Some people do very well with either like skipping or delaying breakfast. Some people do well with, like, you know, the coffee, with, you know, butter, MCT oil, things like that. For athletes, that's where you have to, like, start to look. Although you have to separate yourself from someone that's, you know, maybe going to the gym and doing some weights as opposed to an athlete. And when you train jiu-jitsu, whether you like it or not, you should start to look at yourself as an athlete. Because you are doing, you know, even an hour of jiu-jitsu is strenuous. You know, you're an athlete, so I do think there's a benefit to having something in the morning. Whether you want to push it back an hour or two, it doesn't matter. But I think it's important to keep your insulin level steady, so when you go and train later, you're not having these wild energy fluctuations. So you can do that using, you know, protein and fats in the morning is pretty safe. A lot of the, you know, big name guys in the fitness industry swear by it. You know, Charles Poquin's big. You know, meat nuts in the morning. you'll hear a lot of guys talk about just, you know, approaching the fast in the morning to keep your sugar stable, your blood sugar stable. And I find for me that helps. I'm not a big, if I eat a lot of, like, starchy foods in the morning, I just feel off all day, you know, and I'm obviously just one person. But getting the fats and the protein in the morning will at least give you a good start to the day, so you're not starting with this huge insulin spike and then crashing around lunch, and then you go on this roller coaster.
You mentioned
as far as like ideas,
yeah.
You can make a bunch of hard-boiled eggs and keep them in the fridge. Different types of sausages, not necessarily like breakfast sausages, but like you know, chicken sauce, like chicken Italian sausage, like pork sausage, something like that. It's like a little heartier. Those are pretty quick. So the eggs are good. You can do protein shakes with a little. You just have to make sure you add something to it, like some fats, like coconut milk or something, or else you're going to get an insulin spike from the whey. That's a lot higher than some people believe. And it's also going to leave your stomach kind of fast, so it'll work. You know, at a pinch, it'll definitely work. But you're going to find yourself hungry a lot sooner than you would if you actually eat like a whole food. So, like I said, you can, you know, pre-make eggs, sausages, leftovers, omelets are great, but they do take a little bit of time.
Sounds
things
good.
Like that. Things that you can just like reheat, you know, if you make some sort of like protein or meat at dinner, you could do some leftovers in the morning.
Yeah, all those are good, and they take just a little bit of planning and preparation ahead of time. But they do pay off, probably, right?
Yeah. I would say the simplest one is hard boiling a bunch of eggs, and then you could have something with it. Let's say you want to do, you know, like half an avocado or whatever or something. You could just, that's pretty timeless, you know.
Yeah.
A couple scoops of like almond butter or something. That stuff's pretty fast.
Sounds good, and I think. I'm getting hungry just sitting here.
That popped in my head too. You could do like different beef jerkies if you're really in a time pinch. You can get really good. You can get different like turkey jerky, beef jerky, stuff like that. It's a decent source of protein. You know, depending which one you get, most of them are pretty low in sugar. You know, maybe a little bit of sodium, but as an athlete, you're sweating enough. You need it. That could be that's pretty quick. You can keep in your car if you wanted to.
Yeah, that will keep pretty much anywhere. And can't get easier than that.
Yeah.
Now, with weight cutting, is it necessary to do road work like running?
No, I think with weight cutting, the most important element is the food and the fluid. The training is just, the training actually should be the opposite, to be honest. Like, some people push the hardest when they're cutting the most. So you're trying to push to your training to a new level while you're eating the least. So there's, you know, if you just think about it from that way, it doesn't make a lot of sense. You know, you were doing your hardest training because you want to like push to get the weight off, but you're eating the least amount of nutrients. So the most important thing is actually to watch your nutrition, and then your training is meant to supplement it. So those last few weeks before a tournament, you should start backing off already. And more than likely, you'll experience a nice little weight loss just from the inflammation in your body, just getting rid of the extra water and things like that, because it's finally not so beat up and overtrained. So I would say the number one thing is to watch what you eat. You can get into debates with a lot of people on how to cut weight, how to drop weight. And again, that just depends on what camp you follow, and also are you weighing in the same day, the day before, are you wearing your gi? But as far as like the extra conditioning and stuff like that, you know, it's not going to make or break you. You know, obviously you want to still train, but the way I see it, and this is coming from, if you look at like the, you know, the West Side Barbell method, what they do is they start to make their workouts shorter but more intense. So they're still getting really good training in as they get closer to their competition, but the actual time is shorter. So you might be, for jiu-jitsu, you might do, let's say, like 30 minutes of hard drilling as opposed to an hour and a half class. So your you're cutting back on the time, you're increasing the intensity, and then you're dropping your food intake, and the weight will slowly start to come off. I think that's more important than going out and doing a ton of extra conditioning and things like that. You can roll more rounds if you wanted to, you know?
Yeah.
Like you could spar more rounds, or you could, you know, roll harder. You can do like minute goes. Like there's ways to make jiu-jitsu very exhausting. I don't think you need to spend a lot of extra time going out and doing, you know, road work and stuff.
That's the weight cutting, I think, is one of the nice advantages that the wrestlers have is, you mentioned earlier, it kind of depends on your body. It seems like the wrestlers that cut weight, they know, for me, I do this, and this will take off this amount of weight and this amount of time.
Yes, yeah, exactly. And it's also you got to start thinking about who it is, like who you are, what you do, and what you want to do. So, you know, I've seen this, and I'm sure you have, and I'm sure a lot of the listeners have. Like, I'll be at a tournament, and there'll be guys that are, like, you know, brand new, let's say, like, Masters division, and they're, like, killing themselves to cut weight, right?
Yeah.
You know, think about it. Like this isn't the final, like, black belt division of the world, you know? It's, like, pick and choose your battles, you know? I think you always have to keep that in perspective. Just because you see someone doing this training to cut weight doesn't mean that's the way you should do it. And more people, I think, would be better off, like you said, they look at the wrestler and they see the wrestler cut weight. But that guy's been doing that for years. And he knows his body. He knows how to do it. You've been working in an office for the past 10 years, you know, and you just started doing jiu-jitsu. Like, you're not going to be running around with a garbage bag around, you know, around your chest to cut weight before a tournament.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. So I really think people need to ask, you know, Dan John, a really good strength coach, talks a lot about that. He's like, you always have to think about, you know, who you are, where you're at, and where you want to go. Because that's going to be the driving factor for how you approach everything. And if you're just starting out and you're going to a tournament, and, you know, I think it's great, but I think you don't have to, like, it's not your profession, right? You're not. Whether you win or lose, it's not going to make or break you. So you should be just focused on jiu-jitsu.
Yep, and it always seems like one big stress, you know, the day, you know, of making weight. And if you could take some stress off of you for the event, that would be a good way to do that.
Yeah, for sure.
Going down the list here, next question. Do you have to compete in BJJ in order to get better?
Yeah, that's an often debated one, too. I would say no, but you have to understand where your weak areas are. So what competition does is it shows you holes in your game, I think, really well. Besides the, you know, the fact of, like, you know, you can learn a lot about yourself by competing, and the stress of competing teaches you a lot about how to deal with everyday stress. But that aside, like, competition shows you weak holes in your game. So if there's something that you're struggling with, they'll definitely come out in competition. So for that aspect of it, competition's really great. But you don't have to have that. If you have somebody that's very honest with you and tells you what you're missing. So, you know, some, you know, instructors or coaches are very good at telling their students, like, what's missing from their game. And I think if you have someone that does that, and you're not the type of person who likes to compete, then you'll be okay. It's just if you run into the situation where you just don't have, you know, it could be a friend, it could be somebody you train with all the time. You just need somebody to be like, this is what you're having trouble with, or this is where I'm exposing you. You know, you have to have some sort of, like, voice of reason, so to speak, someone that's going to tell you what you need to work on. And I think if you have that, you don't necessarily have to compete if you're not the type of person that likes to compete.
Yeah, I think you're right on. That's one good thing about jiu-jitsu is you do get a lot of immediate feedback from your training partners. They may not always tell you this is what you did wrong, but you usually know if you messed up. You know, like, you know, you got mounted in armbar real quick. Well, okay, I probably made several mistakes.
Yeah.
But it's up, part of it's up to you to ask, you know, what could I have done differently? You know, but I think sometimes gyms kind of develop a style, that the way that similar a lot of times to the way that the instructor teaches, you know, and then you go and you compete with someone from a different gym. They may do one or two things a little differently that might kind of catch you off guard and throw you for a loop. And that helps keep you grounded and
out there learning this stuff. That's a good point, too. With competition, it does expose you to different games, too. That is one thing that you'll definitely experience in competition. You might, you know, face a guy from another school that has a different style. So from that aspect, yeah, competition will bring that out. Some schools, like, you know, at Newbury, where I'm at, we have open mats on Saturday. We have, sometimes people come from different schools and whatever, and it's a really nice training environment. You get to see different styles, too, you might not see before. So I think if your school, like, you know, most schools get visitors that come in, stuff like that. So if you get exposed to different styles and things like that, you'll be okay. But, yeah, if you just stick to your school and, like, not a lot of visitors come or you don't venture out, you only see one type of jiu-jitsu, when you go to a competition, you are going to be in for a rude awakening.
Yeah. Well, that's why open mats are so great for everybody who goes. And if you have the right mindset, you can learn a lot and you can have a lot of fun and meet new people.
Yeah, definitely.
The next question here, how many times a week should I strength train?
Good question. That number is going to be directly related to how often you train jiu-jitsu. So the more jiu-jitsu, the less of the strength number, if that makes sense. The less you can get, the least you can get on the mat, the more you can strength train. So if you don't have the option to get on the mat very frequently from work or for whatever reason, and maybe where you work has a gym at lunch or something, you know, a gym you can go to at lunch, you might be spending maybe 3 or 4 days a week doing strength training because you can only get into the jiu-jitsu gym, you know, once or twice. But if you're going to get to jiu-jitsu 3-4 days a week, you know, I would say for the average person, I'm not talking like elite competitors yet, like just the average person, you know, 2 days is plenty. Well, one maybe upper body focused, one maybe lower body focused. Like, there's different ways to play around with that, but 2 is probably safe. If you're getting on the mat a lot, 1's probably sufficient for the average person. Now, the high-level competitor, they're going to be a little different. They might spend a little more time doing some very specific strength work or very specific conditioning exercises in addition to their jiu-jitsu training. But they also have that freedom. They're younger. They do that full time. They have the ability to just go home and rest and recover, whereas most people have to go to work and they're sitting on a desk or stressed. You know, they're two distinct groups that, unfortunately, I think sometimes people look at the competitors, the high-level guys you see, and see how they're training and think that that's what's best for them. You know, like, they're getting on the mat 5-6 days a week, twice a day, and then doing strength conditioning however many days. And that's just not going to happen for the average person.
Yeah.
So you do it was best for you. 2 days is more than enough. If you're just getting on the mat, you know, if you get on the mat 3-4 days a week, and then if you're getting on the mat more, you just need one day of a really good strength and conditioning program where you're really taxing, you know, all the different muscle groups. It should be enough.
You mentioned that 1 day a week could be okay. And would you, okay, so let's just say I work every Monday, I do my strength program at the gym. Should it be like that one Monday I do upper body, the next Monday is lower, and then switch them around, or do I have like a general workout every once a week that kind of gets everything?
Yeah, I would do general strength exercises for the for the main group. So you, let's say you pick a main movement for your upper body. Let's say I'll use bench press because everybody knows bench press.
Yeah.
And deadlift for lower body. So you have like your two main movements, and you can vary those. You know, you'd probably want to do some type of like, you know, pressing overhead, you know, or like a bench, some type of squatting pattern. And then everything else is going to be built around the accessories to bring up your weak areas or to counteract, you know, some of the imbalances from jiu-jitsu. So you have your two main lifts for the day, and you push those pretty heavy, you know, to the, I don't want to say failure, but, you know, you move some weight. You get a really good, you know, strength workout. And then you pick your accessory movements to bring up your weak areas or to help you with your, you know, correcting imbalances or whatever it may be.
It seems like I've had a couple different times in my life where I didn't really touch weights or didn't really – I don't do it a ton with the weights, but I do get in the gym once or twice a week and do a little bit. But it seems like going from nothing – to doing some weights, there's a significant gain there. What kind of expectations should somebody have if they, you know, they've been trying, they're a blue belt, they've been training, and then they're going to add weights now. They're going to add some strength training. What kind of a gain can they expect to see within even a few months?
Oh, that's a great question. Let's look at someone that's never really done a strength program before. You're going to experience, I guess some people call it like newbie gains. Like they'll get stronger at a faster rate than someone that's been training for a while. Now, not all of that is quote unquote like muscle. Like, are you going to put on significantly more muscle right away than someone else? You know, maybe not. But what you do have, what does happen is your nervous system, everything gets really efficient in those patterns. So like when you deadlift for the first time, it's like trying to do an armbar for the first time.
Yeah.
It's really hard. Like, you might do one rep and you're like sweating and your abs hurt, you know? And like, it's just so inefficient. But over time, you get really efficient in that movement. The same thing happens with lifts, with deadlifts and squats, all that. So your weight on the bar will go up just because you're better, your technique's better, you're more efficient in that movement pattern right away. So that you'll see within a few weeks, to be honest. Like, some people see it, you know, 3-4 weeks in, they'll start like having big jumps in weight just from the fact that they're learning how to do the movement better. Now, as far as that like blue belt goes that hasn't strength trained and now he's adding it or she's adding it, the first thing you'll notice is your recovery between rounds will get better. Not for the fact you're getting better shape, but you're more efficient. Like, your muscles are just using less of like a max effort, so to speak, when you're rolling. So you have a little bit left in the gas tank. Like, I've seen people, that's usually the first thing I ask people is, how is the recovery between rounds? Before I ask them, like, did you feel stronger rolling?
Yeah.
Because that's kind of relative, you know, if you've been doing jiu-jitsu for a while, like, you know, everybody's pretty strong, so to speak, like in jiu-jitsu. But you start to notice, like, you recover faster. And if you, you know, let's use the example of standing up from the guard. So let's say standing up from the guard with the guy's legs closed is very similar to, like, a deadlift or a belt squat or something like that. And you fight middleweight, so 181 with the Eon. Your max lift is 180. So every time you stand up, essentially, you're doing a max lift. You're lifting 180 pounds every time you try to stand up, so to speak. Plus, the guy's trying to, like, fight you, so
yeah.
It's probably worse. But you can squat 300 or 400. Now, every time you stand up, it's, let's say, 50% of your max, 60% of your max. You're just using less energy, less, you know, it just takes you less strength, less muscle, less energy to perform the exact same movement. So you'll get more efficient. And that's why I think you'll start to recover a little bit faster. Like, you're just not working as hard to do the same thing.
I see.
And sometimes people will get, it'll come across in different ways. Like, let's say a hip bump sweep is a good example. You go for a hip bump sweep, and before you like get the guy to tip, and then he would like power back through, and you'd end up in the guard again. But now you went for a hip bump sweep, and your hip, you're just like strong enough to finish that sweep, like to follow through with your hips. So for me personally, that's usually where I notice it. When I start, you know, if I'm ramping up my strength training, I will notice it in that. Like, I can finish sweeps a little bit easier than I used to. Like, I'm not working as hard to finish, like, a butterfly sweep or something. As opposed to before, I'd, like, have to work a little bit harder. You know, I'm like, oh, man, I actually was able to, like,
yeah,
I didn't feel as bad as usual. So, for me, that's where I see it. Some other guys see it that way, but mostly it's that, for most people, it's that recovery piece first. Between rounds, it's like, oh, yeah, I was, like, fine in a minute or something.
Yeah. It sounds like you'll feel better because you're not using your maximum amount of muscle that you have to get the job done. And then it sounds like, especially for your sweeps, your opponents are going to feel lighter as you're able to move them around.
Yeah, exactly. And if you really take the time to understand a lift, like a deadlift is, you know, deadlift's complicated. If you really break it down, like the guys that are, you know, really good power lifters, like they're technicians, you know, like they look at a deadlift the same way a black belt looks at doing jiu-jitsu, you know, or a guard pass or something. Their grips are a certain way, their feet are a certain way, their posture is a certain way. And you'll gain better positioning on the lifts, and it'll also help you in jiu-jitsu. So let's say now you have the ability to get a little bit, you know, more drive with your hip, or you can, you know, one of the common areas is people don't finish like squats or deadlifts. They kind of get to the top of the end range, but then they stop. So now maybe because you spent the time learning the lifts, you can get like a full range of motion, or you have strength at the top of your hip, you know, your hip drive or whatever.
Yeah.
So some of it is that, like, you're getting better, like, positioning, and you're getting stronger throughout a full range of motion where before you didn't have it.
Sounds very good. Going to the next question here, it's kind of a big one, but what is the best strength and conditioning program for Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu?
Yeah, that's... Best one. The best one is the one you can follow.
Okay.
It is a simple answer. The big answer is it's a program that allows you to get a benefit in the weight room for what it is you're lacking or you're missing without getting in the way of jiu-jitsu. So no program, no matter how great it is, for a jiu-jitsu athlete specifically, should get in the way of their jiu-jitsu. So I would say a good program addresses specifically what the athlete needs without interfering with their sport. You know, sometimes people will come into class and they'll look like not themselves. You know, they'll look a little slower, just like they're just dying for no reason. You know, like, hey, what's, you all right? You know, like, oh, I just did a killer workout earlier or something like that. So to me, that signals like their strength program or their workout didn't help their jiu-jitsu. If anything, it got in the way, you know? So the best program is going to be one that gives you everything you need without sacrificing your jiu-jitsu. And you can do that a million ways. People can do it with barbells, you know, kettlebells, and the stuff we were just talking about, body weight. Like, you know, I am a big fan of, like, the individual. You know, like, there are some general principles that everybody needs, but everybody also has specific imbalances or weak areas that need to be identified and addressed.
Yeah, and you mentioned that your program does not get in the way of jiu-jitsu. When you first said that, I thought of two things. Some guys, you know, they pack on the muscle enough to where it seems like, maybe it's not true, but they might lose some flexibility, you know, especially in their shoulders, their arms. Like, they can't move their arms the way they once could. And then another way that I think, you know, it can get in the way is if they go instead of training jiu-jitsu. Tonight I'm going to go to the gym and lift weights opposed to go to jiu-jitsu. I got a good training partner of mine who, when we do train on Fridays, it's just hit and miss on my schedule. I'll text him and I'll say training today, or we're not training today. And when we can't train, he goes and he does bench press. It's kind of a joke we have going on.
Yeah.
The time factor, and then also maybe over building certain parts of your body perhaps could get in the way of jiu-jitsu. Is that, am I making any sense with that?
Yeah, no, for sure. You don't want, like you said, overdeveloping and something or whatever can definitely limit jiu-jitsu. And sometimes people still strength train or do their, their weight program as if they were not doing jiu-jitsu. So if you, let's say you had a routine of, doing a workout, whatever, bicep one day, back the next day, whatever, you're doing jiu-jitsu, your priorities need to switch, right? So your priority isn't no more, bodybuilding or powerlifting or whatever, it's just jiu-jitsu. So one, sacrificing that time to be spent on the mat for the weight room is getting in the way, and then two, you don't need huge biceps to be good jiu-jitsu, right? You don't need huge boulders for shoulders to get good jiu-jitsu. And like you said, sometimes people get so, so big or so hypertrophied that limits the range of motion. There's been plenty of really big guys that have come in that are, very strong, but as soon as you just get a grip for a Kimura or an Americana, they tap because their shoulders are so tight.
Yeah.
The difference is the goal, right? Maybe that guy, if your goal is to be as big as possible or, bodybuilder, power, whatever it is, then that's your goal. And jiu-jitsu is something you do on the side that is to complement that. And you shouldn't get too upset if things like that happen. But I think most of the people that I know that come in and listen to the show, they want to get good at jiu-jitsu. So all that stuff has to take a back seat. All that stuff has to change in order to meet your goal of getting better at jiu-jitsu.
Yeah. When I first asked you this question, what's the best strength conditioning program you could do for jiu-jitsu? You said the one you stick with. I love that answer. It's so simple. And it's like if somebody gets all fired up and motivated listening to you today and they try to get a program together, it's, they're not able to enjoy it or stick with it or see what they want, change it. Don't just quit doing it. Maybe just change it a little bit and see if you could find one that you want to stick with and incorporate in part of what you do. Answered the question, I really like that. Going to the next question, what supplements do you recommend?
Man, some great stuff right there from Sam Spiegelman. The guy is just a wealth of knowledge, knows strength and conditioning, jiu-jitsu inside and out. And we actually, the good thing is we have another episode question and answer with him next week. But we'll put a link to how to get a hold of him because he is available for online consultation. So if you've got a tournament coming up or if you're just trying to get in better shape or questions that weren't answered or questions that weren't on either one of these parts this week or next week's, definitely get a hold of him. He will help you out.
Yeah, and like he said in the interview, strength conditioning is a personal thing. I can't go to my doctor and then give Gary the advice my doctor gave me. If you tell Sam your personal story, what's going on with you, he'll be far better able to help you out. So that's a valuable resource if you're wanting to really pick it up a level and get better with your strength and conditioning. So yeah, we'll definitely have that on there. We love to give out ghee patches, and the best way that we've found to do that is to reward our reviews that are left for us on iTunes or on Stitcher Radio. If you write us a review, and hopefully we earned 5 stars, send us an email, bjjbrick@gmail.com. If you live in the U.S., we'll mail you out a ghee patch. Pretty simple. I'll get back with you, get your address and some details, and I'll throw a patch in an envelope, throw a stamp on that thing, and send it your way, my friend. It's just a way to say thank you for helping us out and helping us look better on iTunes and in search engines or wherever. They say that helps a lot getting reviews, so we appreciate that. And it's fun to it's rewarding to get a positive encouragement about the podcast.
Yeah, definitely true. If you like our show, share it with your friends. Let them know about it. Give us a shout out on social media. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter, which we don't use Twitter as much. But and also, we have email, bjjbrick@gmail.com. If you have any questions, you know, just send it our way. Or, you know, if you have somebody you think we might be able to, might need to interview, or questions, concerns, or anything, you know, let us know. Also, this was episode 96. So how many is that to 100, Byron?
It's give or take half a dozen or so.
Yeah. So four. So basically, what we're looking at doing is 100th episode is going to be we want our listeners to participate in this show, where you can basically send in to us what do you call it, Byron?
Audio file. Yeah.
MP3 audio file. Tell us what jiu-jitsu has done for you. It's basically, you know, a shout out to jiu-jitsu. And don't make them 20 minutes, you know, a couple minutes is fine. We want to get as many out there as possible. But it's going to be a feel good, all good jiu-jitsu show. Just to let everybody know how great jiu-jitsu is. If you're not doing jiu-jitsu, what benefits it's done for you, and maybe get some more people training.
Absolutely. It's going to be a great opportunity to help get the word out about the positiveness of Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu. Just email that to bjjbrick@gmail.com as an MP3 file. If you can't make an MP3 file, email me at that same place, and I'll get a hold of you and try to help you out. We'll make something happen.
Or maybe we can use a voice translator and make up some of our own.
Oh, we hope it doesn't come down to that, Gary. But we'll see what trickles in here, and hoping to get a lot of fun stories and learn a little bit about some of the things, the benefits. I'm sure we'll learn something, Gary.
Yeah, it'll definitely be a very, very positive podcast, which hopefully all of our podcasts are positive.
Oh, but that one about the big tragedy that happened on the Mass there, you know, back in the 80s.
Well, that's why I do my own audio books, to take care of that stuff.
Speaking of which, Gary.
Uh-oh.
Everybody wants to know what's up with your audiobook that's in progress.
What one is that? Because I have a couple in progress, Mark. Yeah.
Well, the one that I'm worried of thinking about more specifically coming up here is the book titled What I Learned in Flunking Out of Jedi School.
Well, you know, Jedi School is very important. I mean, it's basically a martial art. I mean, you learn a lot of stuff. You learn stances. You do katas. You basically learn how to swing the lightsaber, stuff like that. And really, a lightsaber, we don't have lightsabers in our world, but it's the same thing as a machete, same thing as a bat. So even though I did flunk out, and I didn't flunk out because of non-performance, I had trouble getting to class on time.
That was it.
Yeah, that was my problem. So basically what I'm going to share is make sure you have a very good alarm clock so you get there on time and you won't fail out.
Oh, Padawans, they're always not setting their alarm clocks quite right, Gary. Send all of your complaints about comparisons of a lightsaber to a bat and a machete to Gary via the Facebook
page. And I know I'm going to get a lot of them.
It's way better than a machete. Gary always
has. I'm talking in today's world.
That's true.
We don't have lightsabers, so we have to use machetes.
When did that happen? When was this time of lightsabers?
I have no clue. I don't think we've ever had it yet.
Oh, I thought it was a long, long time ago.
In a land far, far away.
I'm sure we're butchering our Star Wars facts, but that's another one of Gary's ebooks that is well under development there. And he's always he's working on. You just need to focus on one, man, and get it out there. So
don't be waiting for the release of it, because it may not come.
Well, I'm sure it'll happen sooner than you think.
Yeah.
We got to get Gary in a I almost called you Jerry. We got to get Gary in one of those robes, you know, and get our animation drawn up. That's what we should do. the BJJ lightsaber podcast.
The reason Byron was calling me Jerry because I was talking to him about, we were talking about Caitlyn Jenner earlier. So I think he was trying to change my name.
Off the air, we just talk about Caitlyn Jenner all the time.
Yeah, well, we all have posters of Caitlyn.
There we go.
Yeah.
Learn a little bit more about us each week, my friends. If you're anywhere near the Wichita area, you can learn more about us that way, too. We'll be happy to train with you when we're in Wichita, Kansas, centrally located in the United States. Give us an email, and we'll figure out a time if we're available to come train with you or to have you come train with us and have good times, my friends.
Do you really think somebody's going to want to train with us after we just talked about, if we talk about Caitlyn Jenner?
I expect a flood of people to come in. No. We'll see what happens. You know, you got to throw out the options to people.
Yeah, you never know.
But thank you for listening, my friends. And as always, stay sweaty.
And don't forget to shower.
Thank you for listening. I hope you find the time today to roll. After all, the best way to get better at Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu is to do Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu.
That's true. So take it all in relative. Man, I suck. That's true, Gary.
Speaking of somebody we interviewed, Byron,
yeah?
I think it's time for the question and answer with Sam Spiegelman. You like that segue?
Yeah, but we got to do the article.
Oh, okay. That goes down to the bloopers.
I thought you were going to say somebody we've interviewed has wrote the article of the week from Sand Hills Jiu-Jitsu.
I can't believe that.
That's
I
funny. That's I'm good. Upset.
Oh, well. Take two.